is here until
mid-Feb,
or 12th or 13th.
Okay, and he's going to talk about that.
Great. Thank you, David, and it's great to be back. Okay, so I was recently invited to co-curate an exhibition in Oslo. The inviter was Anna Hilde Nesset, who until just a couple of weeks ago was director of Kunstnernes Hus, this wonderful, can I go to the next slide? Is that it?
Okay. Yep.
This wonderful neoclassicist functionalist building right in the heart of Oslo that's been owned, it's almost 100 years old, it's been owned and directed since its inception by the Norwegian Artists Union. It was the first place in Norway to show Guernica, first to give Warhol a show, and so on. It's a great place. So Anna Hilde's invitation to me was to co-curate an exhibition whose guiding principle would be to unpack the themes and motifs of my novels. Now, it's actually very difficult to say what the themes and motifs of your own novels are. I mean, you don't kind of sit down and say, I'm going to write a novel about the subjective alienation under late capitalism, or I'm going to write a novel about cybernetic structure of desire. You just kind of stumble into it. You intuitively bring a few things into formation, which formation hopefully opens up other potential lines of thinking and kind of passes on the baton to other people to do something else that takes it further. Art making is basically a big open-ended dialogue. So when your own work enters that, you just become another reader. Nonetheless, after a bit of back and forth, we kind of agreed that one situation that does keep recurring in my novels is the holding pattern. The holding pattern, of course, being what air traffic controllers use to keep airplanes in formation around a busy airport without crashing. This is the most common, I would ask you all to rotate your heads 90 degrees. This is the most common type of holding pattern, the teardrop entry. See, you can see because of its resemblance to a yellow tear forming in a red eye, you may put your heads back, but please retain, if you will, that notion of melancholy. So I guess, you know, in my books, they're full of, some of them have literal holding patterns in them. I mean, Remainder ends in a holding pattern. My novel C, which I think I read from in this room last time I was here, the protagonist is a World War I aerial observer flying in quadrants over enemy lines and radioing back battalion battery positions to his posts on the ground. And sometimes it's more figural. So in Saturn Island, the corporate anthropologist hero becomes obsessed with the buffering symbol on the screens through which he kind of extrapolates all the data and subsets of the world around him. In the most recent novel I wrote, The Making of Incarnation, we get this the figure of the assembly, the early 20th century assembly line worker performing her action again and again against a grid so that it could be modeled and in kind of industrial time and motion studies. So these are holding patterns. There's often these kind of human figures nested in suspended or looped animation within the circuitry and feedback loops of techno-informatic systems that hold out the possibility maybe of being mapped or understood, and simultaneously through their opacity or their complexity, hold this possibility just out of reach. So the buffering symbol is a perfect example of this. You can see it, but what you can't see is the enormous networked computational enormity going on behind it. So we decided that both in my novels and in the world in general, the holding pattern has something to say about our condition, a condition of being caught up in processes beyond our control, a condition of anxiety. I mean, we've all been in that situation, anxious when you're looping above an airport. Anticipation, waiting for resolution or revelation or even salvation, being brought home safely. But while we're in the pattern, in the hold, having this end point endlessly deferred. And before I talk about the actual exhibition, I just want to flag up a text that was really important to me and Anna Hilzer when we were kind of thinking this whole thing through, which is Kafka's 1909 text, The Aeroplanes at Brescia. It's very short, you can read it online. It's a beautiful little text. It describes a visit to an air show. His buddy Max Brod said, come on, Franz, we're going to go to this air show and you're going to write something about it. See if you can capture this new phenomenon of aviation. The aviator poet Gabriel D'Annunzio was at the same show. So Kafka, in writing, he shows us mechanics battling to get propellers turning, and then planes taking off and turning around these posts, and spectators on the ground turning and turning as they watch these planes go around the towers and pylons. It's very striking how often that word turn, drei, appears in the text. It's as though the spectacle of aviation were orchestrating a general pirouetting choreography on both air and ground, and of both machines and human bodies. And then right just before the end of the text, Kafka comes up with this amazing, to me, amazing line. He says, the pilot Rougier sits at the controls like a writer at his desk. He ascends in small circles and never ceases to ascend. So it turns out he's not just writing about aviation, but he finds in aviation a model for the act of writing. And I think we can say, given the circles being drawn across the surface of the sky, by analogy, an analogue for making visual art, drawing. So what does a holding pattern in contemporary visual art actually look like? Well, the first piece viewers see when they enter is Susan Phillips's, I should be able to drag the cursor. It's the time cursor. No. Susan Phillips's, well, I'll just let it run. Susan Phillips's piece, Ambient Air, where she, screw some sound. Is the sound coming out?
Barely.
Yeah, it's coming up. So in this piece, we're getting a lot of echo though. I'll bring up the sound and say, what Phillips does in this piece, it was made for a group exhibition in Berlin's Tegel Airport to mark the end of the airport, the decommissioning of the airport. And Phillips hired a tiny little two-seater plane and had herself flown in a literal holding pattern above Berlin and above the airport. And she hummed through a radio headset, Brian Eno's Music for Airports, to the Strasbourg control tower, which then pumped it onwards into the now obsolete waiting rooms and passport control zones of Tegel. The sound will come up in a sec. And the piece is called Ambient Air. And that word air is doing a lot of work. It has three meanings. It means the air through which Phillips flies. It means the media space, the radio air through which she transmits her humming. And it refers to the musical form. She described it as an aria, a melancholy aria. I mean, it's funny, but it's melancholy. It's a requiem for this important airport. In fact, the audience at the exhibition included not just the art crowd, but also rather sometimes teary-eyed former check-in crew flight attendants who were coming in their uniforms, in their old uniforms, for a last get-together. And mournfulness is something that really runs through Phillips's work. One of her earliest works consisted of her taking over the PA system of a supermarket and singing sad love songs to all the unsuspecting customers. One of her most famous pieces, made for Document 13 in Kassel, had her, I'd really like to give you some of the sound of her singing. Can you hear? Kicks in a sec. Thank you. In a minute, you see the airport. Yes, yes. One of her most famous pieces, made for Documenta 13 in Kassel, consists of her putting speakers on the end of this train station's platforms that played, extracted only the violin and cello parts from Pavel Hass's 1943 piece Study for Strings, which was a work composed and performed by prisoners in Theresienstadt concentration camp, the composer Hass and all the performers then immediately being murdered after the first and only performance. And Kassel, of course, not far from Dachau, was part of the same, a rail hub servicing the same, you know, death network. So here too, in Tegel, although obviously the referent is less traumatic, it's also about kind of nebulously mapping, literally nebulously from the clouds, the tracks and traces of a vanished history, an airspace devoid of planes. Now, when we installed it in Kunstnerne's Hus, we installed, there's a Super 8 film and then the sound spills down. We put it at the top of the main staircase with Susan's voice spilling down. And by happy coincidence, the fresco on the top of this, above the staircase, is by the Norwegian artist Per Krug, and it's called The Artist's Thorny Ascent to the Heavens. So it's a very appropriate piece to have this other piece underneath. Opposite Phillips's piece was another work that originates in an aviation story. This is Orca Hodel's Iver. Hodel was a Swedish artist, poet, born in 1919, died 2000. He trained during the war as a fighter pilot and immediately crashed on virtually his first flight, crashed, almost died, spent years in hospital getting filled with mechanical limb and organ replacements, and discovered poetry during his long convalescence. And then in 1963, when Dick Higgins visits Stockholm, this opens Hodel's eyes to the whole world of like John Cage, Lamont Young, and Fluxus generally. So Hodel says, well, okay, I'm gonna be the Scandinavian Fluxus representative. And at this time he's living in central Stockholm, very near the palace. And every day at noon, he hears the changing of the guards. So, you know, as in most changing of the guards ceremonies around the world, the corporal kind of, he doesn't just say it, he shouts the word present arms, yever, present arms, two arms, yever. He kind of sings it, you know, yever. And this infuriated Hodel, because by this point he's a leftist, anarchist, anti-militarist. But he also, it also seduced him because he recognized in it this kind of found sound poem, this long drawn out, yeah, there. And so he makes this book of the single word, yeah, there, drawn out over 48 pages. There are 31,680 eyes lined up like soldiers, a single yeah, and then 66,556 airs capped by a final R. So it's a piece of vanguard typography that Hodel also saw as a kind of musical or choreographic score for other works as yet unnamed. And it also mimics, I think it's quite obvious, it mimics the you know, early computer code. And when he displayed it, he very much framed it, like Phillips, playfully but seriously too, around themes of death and underworlds and mourning. So the narrative that he gave, and that he instructed, in fact, to be placed on gallery walls when it was shown, which we did, was that he died, went to Hades, and was condemned for his sins to recite that poem, Iver, for all eternity without ever pausing for breath. But that, which he did, but when he did this, the other denizens of Hades got so annoyed that they petitioned Pluto to kick him out again. So he was sent back to the world and told to print it, which he did with Cerberus Press. That was the name of his press. A later machinic sound poem that he made is called The Djurgården Ferry Over the Styx. which consists of a horn and engine sounds mixing with the name of Charon, the Greek ferry of death operator, which he made to commemorate his wife's death. And in fact, one of his most famous or dark pieces is called Order Book, and it just comprises, again, strings of codes or ciphers that look like some kind of abstract algorithm, but are in fact reproductions of the transport lists of prisoners to Auschwitz. So Hodel's father was a vaudeville producer. And I just want to hover over this word that I think I've used a couple of times, choreography, because it's a very important term for this show. It comes from chorea, dance, and graphein, to write or draw. So in ancient Greece, chorea named a circular repeating type of dance. But by the Middle Ages in Europe, it had come to name a psychosomatic affliction, St. Vitus's dance, that spread through villages and towns, overtaking whole populations, causing them to move and shake, often quite joyously in unison. And this worried the authorities, who thought it might lead to rebellion. Now, I'd say I want to show a film, but it has to be at a particular time code, which I don't seem to be able to get to. I'd say a much more recent kind of updated version of this choreic insubordination is found in this film by Jean Rouch, the French anthropologist, a film called Les Maîtres Fous, The Mad Masters, which is a 1955 study of the Hauka practices of Nigeria. I wonder if I can, it would be so good if I could, yeah, isn't there a time? Ah, I can see it on the screen, but I want to get to 17 minutes. Does anyone know how to do this? I know, but my computer doesn't look the same as what it was. It doesn't look the same as this. That's the annoying thing. I mean, it's quite a long. I want to show you this bit. So basically, see, I want to get to 17 minutes, but there's no possibility to navigate from on here.
Oh, I wonder if you have to quit out or don't. Do you want to try?
Yeah, because I'll need to do this quite a lot. I need to. Okay,
and
here we go.
Maybe
yep.
From there.
Yeah, I can do it from here. But we've lost the screen.
Well, now if you go forward to your point.
Yeah, I go 17 minutes.
And then restart the show again.
Okay.
And then
play. Does this work?
No.
Ah. Well,
let's see. A second.
It's not. This is going to be a problem later as well. And specific things I want to show at specific time codes.
Is there a way of just seeing your screen when it's
just seeing my screen without? There's quite a few things that I need to show at a particular time code. Sorry, everyone, bear with us. Great, thank you very much. Okay, so if we go to 17 minutes, you get a sense of what I'm talking about here. Okay, so Hauka is a phenomenon that happens when Nigerians who have observed the more elaborate forms of British military pageantry, you know, troopings of the colours, inspections, and so forth, they start organising their own parades that, starting out quite orderly and mimetic, they mutate into convulsive rituals. Paraders become obsessed. They start foaming at the mouth. They enter epileptic trances and so on. Rouch's film managed to offend both the British administrators, who immediately banned it, and African intellectuals, who felt that it recycled racist notions of exotic savagery, which it possibly did, but it remains a huge touching point for filmmakers and cultural thinkers around post-encounter colonialism to this day. And for me, I don't want to go out in case I think for me and for Anna Hilda, this was an important thing for thinking about this exhibition as well, because it seemed to perfectly illustrate the situationist notion of détournement, as articulated by Guy Debord and his colleagues. Détournement actually comes from aviation. It means hijacking an aeroplane. But they used it to mean turning away, rerouting of an oppressive system of signs or codes from its intended path, thus creating movements and moments of contestation and resistance, what we'd call a hack now, basically. And this is, of course, exactly what Orca Hodel is doing with Iever, so the language and commands of the military parade yard, the site of disciplinary control, is transformed through poetry and art, the transformation generating, in its turn, new patternings and new paths and possibilities. So to carry this logic further, in our show, we invited, God damn it, I'll show you the pictures in small. We invited the choreographer, the contemporary Norwegian choreographer, Ingrid Fiksdal, to interpret Iever as a score. And she immediately homed in on this fact that I mentioned of Hodel's father having been a vaudeville producer. And she devised a dance in which two dancers descend the staircase beneath the ascent. And they descend it in a way that starts out all kind of military, but ends up rather kind of Busby Berkeley, Broadway, vaudevillian. And this was performed intermittently throughout our exhibition, usually at the same time as the actual changing of the guards, which takes place, if I go back a bit, you can see it takes place in the building exactly opposite, the palace is exactly opposite and facing the Art Institute. We announced it to the press as a collaboration with the palace. I mean, it was, they didn't know it, but we did.
Sorry, just a moment. The people at home can't see your screen now.
Oh, okay. Well, sorry. I need to get to particular points in the films, because some of them are like 6 hours long and I need to get to like 2 hours, 23 minutes or something. So I just need to be able to have that capability. Is that good? Okay, thanks. So, upstairs in one of the two massive halls of the museum was another choreographic work. God, it's all going wrong. Another choreographic work. I see 26, 27. Here we go. There was another choreographic work, which was Stefan Panhans and Andrea Winkler's Free Roam Achebor. It's an installation amidst kind of traffic and crowd control paraphernalia. In other words, hardware designed for holding, protecting, but also confining, hemming in. There's a crash barrier just off camera as well, like a motorway crash barrier. It's an installation of a film which shows a... No, I want to play the film. Yep. Play. And move the cursor.
God damn it.
I hate technology. Okay, fine. It shows a series of vignettes. No, I want to move the cursor. Here we go. Well, let's move it. It shows a series of vignettes in which humans and digital avatars alternate each other. In other words, humans imitate the avatars, which, you know, imitate humans, performing near identical kind of movements and gestures. So we get humans imitating their own simulacra, reenacting gestures. But Stefan Panhans and Andrea Winkler particularly home in on the glitches, kind of ticks and glitches, when the person doesn't know it's a wall and just keeps trying to go through the wall, and so on. And in interviews, they're very... they emphasize the fact that they see imperfections as a kind of form of resistance, resistance to an ever more streamlined regimentation of bodies under our kind of app-assisted health and wellness, you know, neoliberal deal. Anyone under 50 in this room will recognize straight away that the game being used as the model here is Grand Theft Auto. In fact, it's the Free Roam version of Grand Theft Auto. Free Roam is an unlocked version put out by the manufacturer that suspends storylines so that players can often collectively, with people in different locations, explore the game's world without the strictures of narrative. Or to be even more precise, what they're using here is a user-hacked version of Free Roam called Tsunami, which is where you saw those kind of tsunami waves, the underwater thing at the beginning. So I think it all raises quite an interesting, the question of agency, of control, right? I mean, in a straight up gaming scenario, the player controls the on-screen figure's movements, of course, with a joystick or touchpad or whatever, but only within the confines of the programmer's coding. So if we zoom out, go higher scale, we could see the tens of thousands of gamers sitting at their consoles, twitching their fingers to the same rhythm as kind of puppets of mass corporate control at distance. So a hacking Free Roam version then could be seen as a small revolutionary act, détournement for digital natives, a kind of resting back of power. But then what to make here of the introduction of a yet another twist or reversal whereby actual bodies take their cue from avatars under the direction of two artists. I think it's a very political piece. At the beginning, you saw the two women outside a prison wall, kind of making some political speech. They look like Rosa Luxemburg or Emma Goldman, kind of making some great exhortation in these jerky oratorical gestures. But to what? We don't know. I think so, like this piece and like so many of the pieces in the show, it's a kind of open-ended provocation. Now, opposite this piece, we had in the other giant hall, we had Elizabeth Price's Slow Dance or Slow Dance, D-A-N-S, which is a very complex multi-screen installation. And it's a kind of cross between a social history, a sci-fi story, and a pop song. Price always works with archives, but rather than being faithful to them, she gives herself license to totally make stuff up. So in the first film, it begins with lots of archival images of abandoned coal mines in the north of England. And then this kind of pop song voice comes in and gives us a narrative telling us that groundwater under the mines has joined up into a grid through which secret songs are transmitted to secret rituals and cults and creating these kind of underground dances all around Britain. And then it moves on, and again, this is a bit where I want to show you. I want to show you a film, and I want to show you a particular bit in a film that has a particular time code. Will this work? Yeah, I think it will. So then it moves on to a social history of the tie, the men's tie. And men's tie design, the patterns on men's ties, how they initially encode elite status, but after the 60s, they start following a more informatic logic. And I'm just going to play you a bit of this. Nevertheless, tended to earn at the time, back to some extent.
memory chips.
That might stop. So in the installation itself, imagine this being pumped out at guts-wrenching bass volume, and you've got an idea what it was actually like there. The third film in the trilogy invents, using an archive of formal academic wear, it invents another cult called the Teachers, who are a group of female academics who no longer communicate in words, but rather use what Price calls patterns of breath and vibration of the vocal cords to make distinct, repeatable sounds, to transmit secret kind of illicit knowledge through the kind of information networks of academia. And Price's narrative would have us believe that, like the Nigerians doing the Hauka, these women are studied by anthropologists who debate whether their actions represent manifestations of illness, complex psychological contagion, or rather comprise protests. And the piece ends in this call to get ready for one last slow dance. So in all, it's a kind of speculative disquisition on labor, craft, and knowledge, understood in terms of patterns and patternings, and once more in terms of choreographies. Now the most complex work in the exhibition, which was also kind of the most simple and the most complicated, is Haroun Farrokhi's Deep Play, which was originally made for Documenta 12 in 2007. The way we installed it, we had these 12 screens in a dark room, kind of curving around the viewer like kind of Olympian gods. And Olympian is right, because what Deep Play is a 12-screen rendition of the 2006 World Cup final, soccer final, between Italy and France, that took place in Berlin's Olympia Stadium. It's impossible to show it. I want to show it.
Yeah. That one, maybe just close it. The flow dance.
This is a runs for more than 2 hours and then just goes back to the beginning. So at any given moment, one or two of these screens might be displaying, you know, raw footage of the actual game or close-ups of particular players, albeit ones always overlaid with the kind of data of their velocity and work rate and so on, or the straight or squiggly or curved arrows or whatever vector notation best reveals the current, you know, passage of the ball or the kind of opening of attack angles and so on. But other screens are giving over to a gaming software which seems so prehistoric now, 13 years on, a gaming software transposition of these raw feeds, or a kind of cat's cradle star chart of the kind of play permutations, or a committee of the German Football Association analysts who, again, like Olympian gods, were assembled in this paneled room, sitting at a boards table discussing the flux and tempo and general dynamics of the game as they make notes in their austere folders. Or this one, a general kind of intensity, almost weather-like map, or sections of the crowd. We get the police video of all the different bits of crowds and so on. And sometimes we get what he calls the Andy Warhol shot, just the sky above the stadium where nothing's happening. So I think, as with that first part of Price's slow dance, we're kind of in the realm of mining, but mining understood in its late modern sense. This is data extraction. This is information stripping. And I think Farrokhi's film doesn't so much perform this operation as kind of meta-perform it. It shows its orchestration. The TV editor, whose voice you hear a lot, is very much like an air traffic controller. He's just saying, okay, hold camera 5, bring in camera 2, split screen, cut to camera 4, camera 5 back. You know, he's bringing all these kind of planes into formation. There's a wonderful bit where he goes, go to Claudia Schiffer, go to Clinton, go to Chirac, oh, and that Italian president. No, Claudia Schiffer again. You see the hierarchy. We get the police one, directing officers, police air traffic controller saying, row 7, seat 14, that guy, arrest him. And we see the holding tanks that the arrested people are in. And we also see the more aristocratic version of this, the VIP sections, the VIP car park. So it's a whole kind of social tableau. The title, Deep Play, is taken straight from an essay by the famous anthropologist Clifford Geertz, who writes this essay called Deep Play about the Balinese cockfight, where two cockerels fight to death. Geertz, in this essay, he points out that status through the cockfight, social status is asserted and also through very large, deep bets, risked. And his conclusion is that the cockfight doesn't just represent the social order, but it produces it too. And I think clearly Farocki is making exactly the same point about the football game. And also violence. Violence is the central agon in this game. I want to show you the most significant. Well, I think when you look at the footage of the, not just in the middle of it, but around the edges, the footage of the car parks right there is eerily, especially in the context of Oslo, with its awful car bombing of Parliament in recent memory. It looks eerily like the type of footage you get this, you know, just before the bomb went off. We're always kind of hovering on the edge of some enormous act of violence, which of course we get at 1:53 and 54 seconds. I can take it there. 1:53. When Zidane headbutts Materazzi, which, here we go, on the top left, which Farocki then gets motion capture rendered at one point. We see this little stick figure. I'll just let it run. The really interesting thing, I think, well, Zidane is a fascinating figure. He's been the subject of several artworks. He's a midfielder, which for an American audience, I should point out, midfielders are holding players. Almost always they're holding players. In other words, they hold an attack. They can absorb and calm the dynamic of an attack, hold it. But every so often, once in a generation, you get a special type of midfielder who's a playmaker. And this is what Zidane is, someone capable of making sudden breaks and changing the entire course of play and of a game, which of course he does here. You know, he takes that skill to a totally different level with this momentous headbutt. The most fascinating thing about Zidane's act is that nobody saw it, right? Nobody in the stadium saw it because it was off the ball. You watched the ball, he was way back at the other end. So even for the people there, they only saw it on the replay. I mean, everybody apart from Zidane and Materazzi, including the players, they only saw it in the 2 or 3 minutes later as it was played and replayed and replayed. The French novelist Jean-Philippe Toussaint writes a wonderful piece called The Melancholy of Zinedine Zidane. And Toussaint was himself in the stadium. And his take on it is that this was Zidane's quixotic sortie against finitude, because he said, this will be my last game. So Toussaint says, well, he didn't want the end to come. He didn't want that final whistle. So he kind of tripped himself out of it by getting himself sent off. In fact, Toussaint goes on to say it never happened because Zidane's head has to travel half the way, then half the way again. He calls it le paradox de Zidane. Zidane's paradox. And I think there's a similar logic of non-finitude in Farocki's work. I see this piece as a really important art piece for our century. I think it's a seminal and brilliant portrayal of an event space, but an event space as a space not of the event as such, but of the event's abeyance, the events being held or withheld or put on hold, the events withholding. And as such, I think it's completely consistent with the thought of Alain Badiou, who in Being an Event talks describes the event field as exactly this. An event consists of its own failure to happen. It consists of a hesitation, which is itself absolute. The final piece in our show was Stan Douglas's Luanda, Kinshasa, which follows a similar logic. It's about, it's also like Farocki's piece about the production of a social situation, but here not so much the production of a kind of dominant social order, but rather the production of a possible counter narrative, considered very much in terms of social or racial politics. So what Douglas has done in this piece is a kind of meticulous reconstruction of the Columbia 30th Street studio in New York. This was a legendary recording studio where Aretha Franklin, Thelonious Monk, Miles Davis recorded on the corner there. And beyond the music, it became this hub where it became a hub for Black culture, poets, political activists. People were just generally, and not just Black, but mainly Black culture, would drop by and hang out. It was this kind of very important place. And Douglas has, and again, I need to show you something, and I need to show you something with noise, sound. Douglas has created a 6-hour film. Here we go. Douglas has created a 6-hour film. So we still have the sound from Sudan. He's created a 6-hour loop showing a jam session, an imaginary jam session, replete with not just musicians, but also technicians, journalists, PR people in kind of early 70s gear, groupies, and producers who are very pointedly all white. Now, hold and break, these terms they used in relation to Sudan and football, also, of course, apply to jazz. Douglas is very attuned to the fact that jazz and funk, you know, they bear an intimate relationship to Black history. Jazz ensembles in their very form, as the critic Diedrichson in an essay on Douglas points out, are ways of organizing the collective phenomenon of ensemble play, and hence the musical equivalent of different political fantasies and utopias. And I think what we get in Douglas's piece, both musically and perhaps by analogy politically, is a set of loop cycles leading to a climax that's never quite comes. And I want to, by way of ending, I want to make a quick digression into the work of Fred Mosen and Stefano Harney, which was very important, again, to me and Anne Hilder in relation to this piece. Their book, The Undercommons, Fugitive Planning and Black Study, is also full of talk of holes and patterns, circlings and spiralings in relation to music, knowledge, and politics. They see these three as a kind of triangle that operate according to the logic of the hold and the break. They write, "We wonder if music, which is not only music, is mobilized in the service of an eccentricity, a centrifugal force marking sociality's ecstatic existence beyond beginning and end." So jazz for them in particular, with its endless off transcription, corresponds to a kind of illicit knowledge, like Price's teachers. Held, they write, held close in the open song of the ones who are supposed to be silent. Hard serial information, this brutally beautiful medley of carceral intrication, this patterning of holds and what is held in the holds' phonic vicinity. They keep using the word hold, which, like Aria Phillips, is doing a lot of work. It has many meanings, but the most consequent or concrete one for Mostyn and Harney is the hold of the slave ship, the historical hold, which they see as a site of historic horror, of course, but also counterintuitively and provocatively, they claim that the hold, being the space in which 1,000 cultures, tongues, and dialects were thrown together en route to the New World, where they break out to birth Black poetry and culture, is also, as they put it, the fuge and fugitive run of the language lab, Black phonography's brutally experimental venue. So thus also a model, despite everything, of potentiality, of becoming. You see the same sensibility in the work of Sondra Perry, the artist as well. Mostyn and Harney advocate an art and politics then, which would be what they call fantasy in the hold. And so it is, they write, we remain in the hold, in the break, as if entering again and again the broken world to trace the visionary company and join it. It's a very beautiful and compelling passage, but I think this is exactly what's happening in Douglas's film. Okay, it's a kind of gathering together and a gathering up into a state of, again, you have to imagine big in the installation, you know, your guts will be vibrating with the sound. It's a kind of gathering up and a gathering together into a state of imminence, a kind of potential building up, but also being held in abeyance, okay, in a kind of negative space of non-completion or of non-resolution or even of non-beginning, since this film has neither beginning or end. So Douglas made it, he only shot 40 minutes, but he produced the 6 hours through, rather than using the conventional cinematic technique of shot, reverse shot, shot, he used a kind of looping, circling camera work so that he could piece together different bits of these 40 minutes into 6 hours that never actually repeat themselves, although it's one kind of quasi-repetition all the way around, just like music. David Toop, in an essay he wrote for us, for our catalogue, which I should try and get a copy of here, he points out that Miles Davis's On the Corner, which is the main kind of embedded reference point of this work, was also spliced and looped together from musicians who weren't necessarily, and very usually were not, in the studio at the same time. Miles has just taken bits and kind of spliced them all together to produce something that is not a record of what was actually played. It's something else. It's an imagination of what might be. That's what we're listening to when we listen to On the Corner. So both these works, we could say, are records of events that didn't happen. And in that sense, I think this film really stands for all art, the memory of an event that hasn't happened yet, held in the reserve of its not happening, or the approach route of its potential to take place. I wish I could play the music.
If you close Slow Dance and maybe there's one that's minimized also, slow or close for Rockies.
Use Control V.
Not that one.
Control Z.
Order of history.
Try it now. So you should see.
Oh, I just had it. Vimeo.
Wait, oh, go up.
You see it in there? Vimeo Stan Douglas.
Go up all the way.
You're in a holding pattern.
You're in a holding pattern.
Well, you know what? I'll send out a link because you can actually watch this demo 3 minutes online. So you can hook it up to your speakers.
We can try.
It'll be better on your speakers than here. That's all I have to say. You know, we had this show it's just closed a couple of weeks ago in Oslo. It's going to move to Dortmund in almost a year. With each iteration, the idea is not just to have a show, but to have a kind of symposium and a group of discussions and invite people in, which we've done in Oslo, and we will hopefully do differently in Dortmund and wherever else it goes. But that's in that sense, it's very good for me to be able to talk about it here, and I'm very interested to hear anything it might have sparked in relation to your own thinking. So I'll cede the floor to interventions or questions?
Your list of bookmarks is fascinating.
And I think we've been kind of in a holding pattern of technology when you're having the presentation, when like, so I think there's some metaphorical meaning to it too.
Oh, we're always in it.
So the downloading circle,
yes,
is, you know, like I think we have an ethical obligation to never spend time looking at it. You know, one should always turn away and try to do something else. But in airplane holding patterns, I've often felt quite cradled in them. It's been like there's some grace there. I mean, not if I'm worried about missing a connection, but there's some sense like, okay, I'm safe, and I get to be in this liminal state of air travel for a little longer before I'm back on terra firma. And, I've had to turn off my laptop because it's that part of the flight, so I'm not frantically doing things on my laptop, and it can be a nice state. There can be grace in that, holding better.
For sure. It's like, it's what Simone Weil means when she talks about cadence. And she talks about, she spent time in a factory and said, there's all this rhythm and it's brutal, but what industrial rhythm doesn't give you is cadence, that pause, that what Agamben calls a historical idling of the machine. Historical idling of the machine. When the engine's running, but the gears aren't locked. So that for, in that whole continental tradition, Weil, Agamben, Badiou, that would be the moment of political possibility, but also, I mean, Agamben is great, a theologist. I mean, it's also a moment of grace. And I agree, especially the buffering thing. I mean, there is a promise being made to you by Google and Apple. It's basically, don't worry, we've got you. There are a million data angels dancing on the pinhead of your connection, and we are taking care of you. We've got your flight, hotel, health, whatever, we've got you, there's a net. But then you kind of think, what if it's just a circle? What if there's nothing? So it's the same with the airplane, of course, don't worry, passengers. but yes.
I wonder if there could be a general way of thinking when one could go from a pleasant pattern, holding pattern, to more anxious. I'm thinking about Buñuel's film, The Exterminator Angel.
When they can't leave the room.
Yeah, or, I don't know, Groundhog Day, or things that repeat until they become unpleasant. And I don't know whether there could be like a general way of describing this transition from feeling good to feeling bad, or it's like specific for each situation. And maybe some people will enjoy holding pattern and some people will don't like it from the start. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, repetition is always towards death, right? Beyond the pleasure principle, this is Freud's point. It's about pleasure, but it's always about moving regressively towards.
Yeah, I guess that if the repetition is positive, then breaking the repetition is unpleasant, and vice versa.
Mm. Yeah, it's a good, that Buñuel film is interesting. I mean, they can't leave, they're held, but there's nothing stopping them. And then when they do leave, they all go back and get stuck again immediately. Like, that's their repetition kind of compulsion. But sure, I'd say they're both there, anxiety and pleasure. Yeah. I mean, look at the World Cup, it's incredibly exciting and pleasurable, but there's always the sense, what if a bomb goes off? What if there's a crowd crush? What if there's, and half the work of the kind of managers of a big football stadium is holding that managing that risk, that danger, and keeping the violence on a kind of symbolic level. Yes.
It's funny, the presentation, it brought me back to an experience with art that I had when I was young. And my mother brought me to the MoMA, and it was the first time I saw like a video experiential art. And it was this sort of immersive one with a video of a woman playing like a Rhodes keyboard in a like a rainy day inside of a room. And there's something interesting about like choosing to give space to these just like passive moments, but in this like extended way. And it's sort of what you're presenting here. All these just like little moments that are passive if you're actually watching the game live, or like the art that I saw is just like a woman playing piano. And there's something, I don't know, about choosing to make these moments long and special, I think is something interesting.
Yeah, for sure. I guess one of Dick Higgins's, who I mentioned, one of the Fluxus artists, he has this piece called To Be Held for a Long Time. And it's just a musical instruction to play a single note and press that hold key. Hold it forever, so the note just goes, which is kind of what Walker Hodel's doing with his there he's intervening in this very synchronized, fast, militaristic, you know, movement, and just expanding it towards infinity, which is I think that's a kind of temporal intervention that is absolutely key to art, but I mean certainly literature. I mean, Proust, you know, Bergson, it's just, that's what it is. Just holding and stretching like elastic, this kind of moment. Sure. Yes.
It's interesting that, in a way, holding pattern is movement with no progress, I guess. It's one way to think about it. And it reminded me of the shepherd tone illusion. I don't know if you've heard about it. It's basically this rising tone that goes higher and higher, but gradually another tone, an octave lower, is introduced. And so, and it also rises, and the higher tone is gradually waning away, and the other one is amplified. And so what it creates is this feeling that the tone is infinitely rising, but it never goes anywhere. So I thought it's basically exactly the audio representation of much of what we were talking about.
Yes. So it's funny because this is about more about you and collaboration than it is about work. So when a previous Miller scholar was here, and that was Sam Shepherd, Sam was working on a collaborative project with a childhood friend, Johnny Dark, and they were publishing their lifelong correspondence. And it went horribly wrong. And I remember talking to Sam about it, and he said, you know, I'm not a collaborator. And, you know, Johnny had too much control, and I don't think he has any taste. And so he was using me. And a film was made about it. It was quite sad, actually, because, and I'm wondering, in your case, you're such, you know, you're obviously a control freak in your own right, as everyone, I mean, you know.
Yeah.
And here you come to a world where you've shifted roles, and all of a sudden, so how did that work? Did you feel, yeah, but you're not really representing my thought. Yeah, but I wasn't interested. I don't have any thought. I mean, I don't have a thought to represent. I mean, this is not how I understand art making, and it's certainly not how I understand what I do. I mean, you know, there are contexts, and there are, like Derrida says, there are no books, only other books. And I really think that's true. You know, there's all these works out there, they're fascinating. And, you know, when you write, you're necessarily, you know, I mean, standing on the shoulders of giants is a kind of rather trite way of putting it, but you know, you're plugging into this network, which is already up and running before you came to it. And you're kind of detoning it or curating it or whatever, making it operate in a particular way at a particular point, which you sign. That iteration, that moment. But then it's, as soon as it's signed, it's off and it's getting reworked by other people, which is great. So it's always collaboration. Even when you're working on your own, you're collaborating.
Yeah, but if they'd been shit artists, you would have felt quite different, right?
Yeah, but I got to choose them without Hilda. I mean,
right.
We got to choose our favorite artists, and it being Norway, we could actually make it happen. You know, the funds were available to make it, you know, because this is expensive, complex work to install. And ruinously expensive for it couldn't have been done in Britain or Germany, say. But I found it really pleasurable, kind of dialoguing with the artists. I mean, of course, they had their work, and there's the practical dialogues about how do we install it and so on. But then necessarily, they're kind of talking to each other when they're there. I mean, two of them are not alive anymore, but Stan Douglas couldn't come. But the others were all there and engaging with each other's work, and you know, new ideas are generated by that for me and them and other collaborations. So I see this as a great thing, but there was never any sense like, okay, this is the idea and you have to represent it. That does happen in curating. Kind of bad curating is when a superstar curator kind of says, I've got an idea and now let me find 10 artists to illustrate it. You know, that's very top-down way that usually just produces illustrations of ideas, which is always bad art, no matter how good the idea is. I don't think I could say what the idea is in any of these works, or what they don't have a message or a point. I think they're provocations that raise more questions than they answer, hopefully. Andrea?
This concept of the holding pattern,
yeah,
you said is in all your novels. Is that something you worked out retrospectively?
Yeah.
That you, yeah.
No, for sure. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the first novel I wrote kind of revolves around this. You might remember it, the last Soviet citizen, the astronaut who went up on a 2-month mission, and while he was up, the Soviet Union disintegrated, and then nobody wanted to bring him down because the Russians said he's Azerbaijani, they can take care of it, and the Azerbaijanis said, we haven't got a space program, you know, why doesn't he land in Georgia and the Georgians? So he was up there for like another 2 months. That's a kind of holding pattern. I was just fascinated by this figure who seemed very, you know, like a kind of late modern angel, saint. And then Remainder ends in this kind of figure of eight in a hijacked plane. I didn't plan it. It's just, you realize, it's the same. I think one is writing basically the same book again and again and again, but just differently every time. And so there are just things that keep coming back.
Thank you, Tom. Tom's still here. I still middle of February.